Gary. You can see over my shoulder here, I've got my name up there, and also mikeperry.biz. If you need to contact me for any reason afterwards, by all means, that's one way to do it. So I'm a storyteller currently, but I'm a recovering clown. Now, the recidivism rate on that is huge. Like, you never really recover. They always just reel you back in. It's deep. The sawdust is deep in there, and I'm not going to apologize for that. In fact, I'm going to try to explain what the heck happened. But first, because I'm a storyteller, let me start with this. When I was a kid, clowns were ubiquitous. If you don't have your dictionary, it just means they were everywhere. I mean, this book is still in print. In this book, I think I can. The clown's the hero. The clown is the one who gets off the train and alerts, gets the other train and saves the day. When I was a kid, you had a clown cup. I had a bank, and you put your money in and the dog would jump up and drop the penny. There were clowns everywhere. So when I got into clowning, if someone found out I was a clown, I usually didn't tell people because it would steal the conversation. A clown, that's cool. How'd you get into this? And 20 minutes later, I'd still be talking about myself. And you can't learn that way. So, but what I have learned over time is that if someone finds out you're a clown now, they go, oh, you're scary. You know, why would you do that? It's flipped. And we're all probably here just to talk about, to learn about what happened. Why did this happen? How did this happen? So let me start with a story. About 10 years ago, I was between opportunities, and we all know what that's like. I was looking around. I had a teaching degree, and a friend of mine who's just a phenomenal teacher, he said, look, why don't you come up and follow me around? He was teaching some circus skills up in Maine. Follow me around for a day or two, and if you like it, maybe I can plug you in, get you started. So I flew to Boston. I rented a car that was so small, they could only fit four letters on the hood, F-I-A-T. It was teeny tiny. It was a roller skate, right? So I drive to Maine. I meet with my friend for 2 days in a row, and I'm just in awe because the guy is magical. Now, the second day, we had to drive back. The hotel was maybe 30 miles away. This being the coast of Maine, we're heading kind of southwest on the way to the hotel at the end of the day. And there off to our left, of course, is the mighty Atlantic Ocean. So there's nobody around. It's Maine. I'm driving. I'm following him. All of a sudden, my friend had this old van, probably 150,000 plus miles. Every day we would stack all his equipment inside, you know, and he's putting. All of a sudden he pulls over. And I'm thinking, oh, here we go. You know, we've all been on the road. We all know what that's like. I say, well, no flat tire. Maybe it's water pump. But, you know, you start thinking. And of course, my mind is always somewhere else anyhow. I'm thinking, you know, where do I have to be tomorrow? When do I catch my flight? 100 miles an hour. He pulls over, he jumps out of the car, and he starts walking away from the vehicle. And now I get a little nervous. Like, what's going on? And he's walking away. And I catch up with him. He's got the most beautiful smile on his face. I said, what's going on? He says, look at this. I just had to stop and see the sunset. And at that moment, it put everything in its place. And what's even better is, because of where we pulled off, the sun set in the west on the Atlantic. We had just gotten into this cove where the sun was setting on the water. So that, to me, is the definition of a clown. When you can defy the rules of nature, when you can watch the sun set in the east, that, my friend, is a clown. So how did I get started? In 1974, I went to clown school with a friend from the previous story. In fact, we spent 2 years on the road on the Blue Show. That was 75, 76. And in 77, again, we tag teamed and went to Circus Odyssey. And then life pulls people in directions. He went off to do what he was doing. I got married, finished my college education, and a little restaurant chain called me up one day and asked me if I would like to work for them. And I said, no. And they asked again, and I said, no. And they asked again, and I said, okay, I'll do it for a year or two. And it lasted 27 years. That man from the story is right here. You may know him well. I loved him dearly. Rick Davis, a good friend of mine from clown school, who of course is the godfather of this organization. And so I call this talk Postcards from Chaplin to Joker. Because here are two characters, Chaplin, Joker, who we know well through film, huh? Chaplin, the little tramp, who moved from British Music Hall into a brand new media, film. And he took his character and made it beloved to the world. In fact, 100 years later, we still know who he is. At the same time, within the last 2 years, there's been a character who's grown darker and darker, and now he doesn't even get an article. It's not the Joker, it's just Joker. And Joaquin Phoenix has taken this character to a whole new darkness. So, we're going the wrong way here. So my question became, when they freed the elephants, when the circus folded its train and left town, right? Death defying, and yet they died. Did they kill the clowns? What's happened along the way? Well, in the process, I tried to contact people to find out if my thoughts are on target. If my experience is different than others. One of these people I contacted was David Carleon, because I noticed he wrote an article, which I read, called American Clowns, Performance, History, and Cliché. If you contact me later, I'd be happy to give you the website if you're interested in reading it. David's also written these three books here, Dan Rice, right there. The middle book is his experience as a clown, and the bottom one is Circus Posters. I've got a few myself. So I talked to David, and we talked quite a bit, and it turns out that I actually met him years ago, because he was on the road the year after me on the Blue Show. We met in New Orleans when I was living there. He was the advanced clown for a while, so he had that experience. We ended up with the same questions regarding what happened in the last, say, 15 years. How is it that the perception of clowns, from the funny fool to the scary, evil, spooky person, how did this happen? And so often when you read about this or you try to find out, it seems, first of all, that the information is riddled with fallacies, in my experience, things that just aren't true. Second of all, they start with the presumption that clowns are scary, which is also not true. They became scary over time. In fact, if you look at this postcard right here that I brought up in the corner, the postage stamp is the likeness of Lou Jacobs. Now, about 2 years ago, Fred Rogers was made into a postage stamp. And it's normal that postage stamps are people that have already passed. So he had passed, they made him a postage stamp. So in 2018, our beloved Fred Rogers, being from Pittsburgh, I can say that, got a postage stamp. In 1966, our beloved Lou Jacobs got a postage stamp, and he was still very much alive. So comparatively, this tells you the esteem that the circus clown was held. He had his own postage stamp. 30 years later, what happened? Let's find out. By the way, in speaking with David, he made it clear to me that the term cholerophobia, which is being thrown around so much right now, is kind of an inventive term that's really quite recent. Within the last 20, 30 years, it kind of popped up. And it's cobbled together from words that really don't make sense. For example, medically, it is not a phobia. It is not recognized as a phobia per se. And also, cholera, the root word, comes from stilt walker or stilt man. It's an odd combination that doesn't make sense. So here it is. Postcards from Chaplin to Joker. Here's a picture of Charlie Chaplin in the movie Modern Times. In modern times, machinery kind of eats him up. He becomes a cog in the wheel of industry, right? So these two pictures are a little more than 100 years apart. Let's talk about 100 years. 100 years ago, film was relatively new. Film is still great because it's one of the only ways we can compare the past with the present. There aren't many films of Lou Jacobs or Otto Greenland, so we have to rely on the film clowns. And here's the best, right? Chaplin. in the era when this picture was taken, circus was at its best, its biggest, its greatest. In the 20s, in the 30s, Ringling Brothers and Barnum and Bailey had already merged. There was just one giant. And if you wanted to see the circus, chances are that's what you saw. It was this huge tent, a portable building that went out into the agrarian society. So the farmers, they didn't have time to leave their cows that needed milking twice a day, to leave their fields that needed to be weeded and tended to. The farmers were slaves to nature. The whim of weather, the call of the cow, they couldn't leave. If they wanted to see entertainment, it had to come to them. So the circus came to the agrarian society, and it brought entertainment. It brought a museum of oddities. It brought a zoo. Who had seen an elephant or a zebra if you lived in Nebraska in 1900? Well, perhaps the 1800s, huh? By the time Chaplin came around, in this shot, you've got industry taking over. You've got the Industrial Revolution. You've got people moving from the farms to the cities. You've got on a farm where you are existing interdependent on the community. Now you can exist, maybe the family unit versus the community is the structure. And then of course, by the time you convert to digital, now you have somehow the clown has regressed into this person who is, quite honestly, I saw this film and I would describe him as mentally ill. It's a descent. So let's see. Let's take a little history lesson and see if we can figure this out, because I'm not sure I can, but I'd love to share it with you. Here is a photo right here of Ringling Brothers Circus on this date, July 17th, 1956 in Heidelberg, Pennsylvania. That's about 20 miles from where I live right now. If you're heading south out of Pittsburgh on 79, there's an exit that says Heidelberg. And you get off and there's a plaza there now. It says Heidelberg Racetrack Plaza. If you look at this picture right here up in that corner, that's a racetrack. That's a circle from the racetrack. They set up right there and they tore it down and they packed the tent up. That was the last day of the tent. And you can see how bloated the circus was. I mean, just miles and miles of tent and canvas and people. So in 56, it was bankrupt. From what little I know, they were having some issues with unions. I mean, it was just a big industry that was too bloated. Two brothers named Felds bought into it. At that time, they were promoting rock and roll with a man named John Hoffeins, who was a judge. Judge Hoffeins was his name. And what I find interesting is Judge Hoffeins' claim to fame was that in the 60s, he opened the Astrodome, which was one of the first, if not the first, domed stadium. And it was round. The circus tent is round. I thought that was interesting that it stayed in a round building, because if you study sociology, traditionally, any community or nomadic group that travels lives in round buildings. When they stay in one place, they build square buildings. Indians have teepees, and northern natives used igloos. Africans who traveled had their huts that were round. So I find it interesting that the circus, when it was nomadic, it was round, and when they moved indoors, it became square. Here's a picture of Dan Rice. And again, you guys probably know more circus history than I do, but Dan Rice is credited as being the model for Uncle Sam. He was in the same era as Abe Lincoln. And David Carleon told me he ran for president, which was I was not aware of, but supposedly Mark Twain used him as a example. He was a humorist and very verbal. So there's 100 years of clowning right there, 1860s and 1960, huh? Still top of the charts. All right. So there's a little history lesson. Now at the same time this is going on, I want to talk about what I call clown noir. Clown noir, the dark side of clowning. I'm gonna suggest that it's always been there. It just rose and eclipsed the clowns that we know. For example, here is a playing card known as the Joker. Now, Jokers are supposed to have been invented to play a game called Euchre. And Euchre was made famous by the Germans in the 1860s. So at the same time, Dan Rice in the 1860s is the world's most famous clown in America. The Joker pops up in playing cards. Of course, the Joker is the character that Batman got a hold of. And it went from books and comic books in the 40s right through these iterations here. Here are six iterations of the Joker character, beginning with a campy character played by Cesar Romero. Is that correct? Cesar Romero? And I don't know if you can read the dates. We've got 1966. Here's Jack. Jack was 1988. So there's 20 years there, right? Now it starts compressing. This one I'm not familiar with. Evidently, there was an animated version, 1992. Here's Heath Ledger, 2008, all the way to 2019. So between Heath Ledger and Joaquin Phoenix, there's only 11 years. So all of a sudden, you can see it just compressing and getting darker and darker, right? And here's a quote from Joker. Sorry, Charlie. Charlie being Chaplin, right? Is it just me or is it getting crazier out there? All right, so now we go back to the circus at the same time, 60s, 70s, 80s. I call this the halcyon days. I call this just the limelight of circus. This is when Feld Brothers took over. 67, they started clown school. The joke, the quote that Irvin Feld said is the clowns were in their 50s. They could take a fall. They just couldn't get up again. So here's an air picture of Winter Quarters in Venice, right? And then here's a red show. They split the show in half. You had the red show and the blue show. They rotated. Feld, I think he pictured himself as a P.T. Barnum. He had been producing all the rock and roll bands of the 50s and 60s. He was the right man at the time, Feld Entertainment, to build the circus into what it became, what I knew it as. 7 years after clown school started, I met a couple of people who were lifelong friends. Rick Davis was one of them. Peggy Ford is another. We went all through clown school together. The 70s, of course, is what I know of the circus. And even the 80s, I think it was at its prime. I'm sorry, I keep going backwards here. Just to give you a flavor of what was going on when I was on the road. I was on the road in 75, 76. Bob Dylan was applying whiteface and doing a show called the Rolling Thunder Review. It was kind of a vaudeville style program that he played in smaller houses. At the same time, it was the bicentennial of the United States. So the whole United States was hepped up red, white, and blue. You also had Watergate, you had Vietnam. In 75, the leading movie was Jaws. So let's talk about fear. The next year, 76, it was The Omen. So again, you have clowning way up here and all the joy and the beauty of circus. And counterpoint is a reality that's underneath. They start to, where's the tipping point? All right. Again, we've gone from agrarian, and I'm trying to whip through this so I can get to the good stuff, right? We've gone from agrarian to industrial, right? And when industrial America grows in the 50s, in fact, in 1955, you have two major industries that we all know and love. One is McDonald's, started in 1955, and the other is Disney. And the third is me. I was born in 55. But advertising age awarded McDonald's, right here, advertising age, this says, advertising age recognizes Ronald McDonald as one of the top 10 icons of the 20th century. Now, I think I mentioned that I worked for a restaurant chain for 27 years, and that guy right there looks kind of familiar to me, but I'm not here to promote anything other than to say it is not accidental that a restaurant chain is as successful as McDonald's cherry-picked clowns from Ringling to represent them in the field. They franchised clowning so successfully. You know, there had been Bozo and a couple other things going on, but our job, our title was Ambassador of Goodwill. These three characters right here were tied for recognition worldwide by children of all ages. one of them no longer, well, Ronald McDonald has totally disappeared except for the Ronald McDonald House. And my question becomes, is there a live character for children to identify with? And I'm at a loss. There are cartoon characters, there are animated characters, there are virtual characters. And there's never really been a good female character. Wendy existed commercially, but only in sales. Ronald McDonald existed. I did two shows a day in schools for almost 27 years. I was in Whiteface for almost 30 years of my life. So in that process, I got to see every single day, I got to feel reactions. And 90% of them, no matter how I felt that day, I put the face on, walk out, and kids would run to you and hug you because the image portrayed for this character on TV was loving and giving and caring. We didn't have to work at all to establish we. I mean, if there's only one, it's like Santa, there's just one. Did not have to work at all to establish who I am or what I do. Just the opposite. All you had to do is pour a message into that empty vessel. That was the 80s and 90s. Around the 90s, here's 87, another Halcyon picture, an indication of the success of Clown School. 20 year anniversary, about 50 a year, 20 years, 1,000 people graduated. In my class alone, we had Bill Irwin, we had Rick, of course, and Peggy Ford.
Barry Lubin.
Barry Lubin, thank you. It goes on and on. Ruth Chaddick, Mitch Fredis. I once sat down and just looked for everybody. Steve Laporte. I would say over half of our class remained in entertainment for their life. A very good friend of mine in New Orleans, in California, is a very successful magician. His name is Phil Van Truen, Phil Van T. And if they weren't directly involved, they were indirectly involved. And that's just like a 2 or 3 month window of time. And I see Jeff shaking his head there because you're definitely responsible for some of this happening. Well, you plant a seed and stand back because you don't know where it's gonna go. So here it is, 87. 10 years later, the school was gone. All right, so again, just to balance it out, here's the teeter-totter. Stephen King, 1986, comes out with the book It. In the book, the first character is killed in 1958, 27 years later, 1986, 27 years later, 2013. And I love irony. I always look for patterns. 27 years is how long I started with McDonald's in 86. I ended in 13. And when I left, that's what people were saying. I'm afraid of clowns because of It. Did you see this movie, It? I read the book and I was not impressed. I think Stephen King's done better work. Here's Jeff. Jeff, I hope I have your statistics right. You were dean in 97, is that correct?
Dick Monday was, but I could have been. I was one of the teachers.
Oh, okay. I have you down as dean. I just gave you a raise.
Just Dick keep it there.
That's okay, because Dick Monday was also in our class.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And how about the rest of it? Please do me a favor afterwards. Contact me and I'll correct this. 2010, founder director, yes. 2007, the clown. And yes. Again, I look for irony and I look for patterns. And I thought it was hysterical based on what we're talking about today that the clown you played was the dead clown. Is that correct?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So there you have it. There's another little tidbit like irony for 30, Alex. All right. So here's, now I get to jump off. Now that I can say that's the past, here's what I see happening. And this is my theory. And I'll try to talk quickly so we can talk about this afterwards. Once we went from industrial to digital, once we entered the information age, what I saw happening with audience members was the cell phone. In the field, previous to this, if I showed up at an event and people wanted pictures, They either brought a camera, or sometimes as a fundraiser for the Ronald House, we would take Polaroids and sell them. And it was like Santa. You would sit there, the child would come over, you get your picture, they'd pay a premium and get their souvenir. Once digital cameras came into being, the entertainer lost privacy and lost control. And by that, I mean, if you were in makeup, you were performing because anyone could walk by at any moment and take a picture of you doing anything. You no longer had control of the stage. And I'm talking specifically here of my experience as Ronald McDonald. I think Mickey Mouse, they've done a huge, tremendous job of managing that. You only see Mickey under certain circumstances. They really have him packaged. And of course, Santa is kind of in a separate entity also, because he doesn't just sell hamburgers, he sells everything. So everybody likes him because there's got to be something he's got for you. And I'm not promoting one way or the other. I'm just saying he still exists. Once the digital camera entered the field, I started to see the change. The other thing that happened is before digital, if a child was afraid, they looked to their parent, their adult, or who they were with for guidance. And I remember more often than not, I still laugh thinking about it. If you hold your hand out to maybe a three-year-old where they're very standoffish, sheepish, and they don't want to shake your hand, but you can feel there's a little there that you can work with, I would usually address the adult and say, boy, am I scared, mimicry. Am I scared? I sure would like to shake his or her hand, but I don't know. And so I'd be talking to the adult and holding my hand out to the child. And because you have your hand out and you're big, the child would, without thinking about it, shake your hand, even though you're ignoring them. And that contradiction was hysterical. You know, it's like they didn't even know they were doing it. And it happened almost every time. So in the past, that would work because the child would take their cues from power from the adult from who's with them. Once they had the phone, there's a subtle power shift that goes to the phone. And for a while there, it seemed that children understood digital more than the adults. So it really gave the power to the child. Now I think there's a generation that have grown up that understands digital. They grew up with digital. So that's gone away. At the same time, I did read this for homework. I did read this in the past, Jeff. Put me down for a yes on that. And going back to Jeff, I want to say this. When I read this book, the timing was beautiful. I want to say 97. Is that right, Jeff? 98?
When I published it?
Yeah.
Oh, no. That was in 2016.
Thank you.
Give me credit for writing much faster than I actually write.
No. It tells you where my brain is at. What I enjoyed the most about this book is that you, sir, have transitioned from Ringling. You took me from Ringling to Cirque du Soleil. And that was from like the old circus with animals and three to the new circus that is digital, which is what we're talking about now. I also, as a storyteller, am familiar with the trickster as a character. And Jung talks about it specifically in this book. And it's interesting because I think this is a pivotal thing. The trickster in folklore, the trickster in legend and myth can be both good and bad. The angel, the fallen angel, the dark side of the positive, yin and yang, up and down. So in some ways, that's what I see that's happened. And we can talk about why in a minute, but it would be the trickster, for example, in Native American lore is very often the coyote, right? And we're all familiar with Roadrunner cartoons. And Roadrunner cartoons are great for combining both that coyote as trickster and clowning, because it's classic clowning. You know, you drop the anvil on the guy's head because he deserved it. But he takes the anvil off and he's okay. You hit him with a hammer, he's okay. It's a clown, right? But what's happened with the dark side, what's happened with Joker, is that the coyote, Joker, he doesn't hit him with an anvil. He cuts his head off and laughs. So there is no replaying. The Roadrunner doesn't get up and say, beep, beep, and run away for the next episode. There is no next episode. It's gone that dark because of fear. So that's duality, good and bad, right? All right, so here it is. This gets us to the point right here. Scary Clowns. Here's a book I picked up called Scary Clowns. I open it up. First, it's all pictures. There's a couple pages of writing. First page, right? Gacy, Lou Jacobs. Here's the back of the book. This is a quote. Chaurophobia needs to be eradicated for the sake of the many who suffer from it. I think this represents a lot of what is out there, the confusion, the mixed messaging, the crazy insanity of it all, right? And that's kind of the new millennium. That's the logical fallacy here, is that clowns are scary. Here's why. You start with a conclusion and then pretend to prove it. There's no proof. You've already stated. Do you beat your children often? I mean, there's that sad twist of logic.
We have a person asking in the chat, who wrote that Scary Clown book?
I prefer, that's a very good question. Scary Clowns, copyright 2006. Thank you for telling me that. You know what? I do not see
no one wrote it.
This. I'm sorry?
Nobody wrote it.
Nobody
it
wrote
just it. Just appeared.
Yeah, and you open it up. There's, you know what? I honest to God, there is no author listed on this. But if you Google Scary Clowns, you will get this book. I guarantee you.
So follow up question of publisher.
I'm sorry.
Follow up question of publisher.
Yes, Andrews McMeel Publishing. Andrews McMeel, and again, I think we're about 2/3 done here. I'll try to talk fast and carry a big stick. Here's what I did find, and I'm very pleased with it. And this is where I open it up for you to think about. I found an author. She's a literature instructor who's since passed, and I'm sorry to hear that because it's rather recent, and I'd love to contact her through the University of Chicago. She did not coin this affect theory, but she's applying it to what she's calling the new age of anxiety. Anxiety and fear are so closely linked. And from obviously 2001 in the United States, once 9/11 happened, I think anxiety became out there, right? It was ubiquitous, it was everywhere. Let me just read this. It says, somewhere along the way, doing good has come to seem irrelevant, or maybe it just felt impossible. So where does that leave the clown? Her book is called Cruel Optimism. And I have that, I was hoping to have read it by the time we met, but I have it on hold at the library. So here we are. This is extending on this. I call it the era of algorithms, the illusion of choice. Now, if you have Pandora, my kids don't even have a radio except in their car. So they rely on programs such as Pandora because it plays what I like. That's what people say, but I prefer to think that it plays what it thinks you like. And as a result, you never know what you like because you're no longer broadcasting, you're narrowcasting. It is narrowcasting. It is telling you what you like. And so if you hear one song, I don't like that, then it will make choices for you about what you don't like. So in this digital age of algorithms, I suggest that anyone with a phone, little people, are being told what they like and don't like without their knowledge. In that process, in 97, Ringling closed Clown School, and please correct me if I get these dates wrong, because I'm not trying to be so specific with dates as I am to paint a large picture. 97, I think they closed Clown School. 2016, I believe, the Ronald program went away. You will not see any vestiges of this person, this clown, in the stores. You will, as far as I know, you don't even see Happy Meal toys anymore. Once upon a time, that was right in the lobby of the McDonald's. And once upon a time, you would see Ronald's hand holding a child's hand everywhere. I mean, it was on menus, it was on walls, it was everywhere. So yeah, it's gone. So here's that illusion of choice, as I said. In that process, someone said this, I don't know where this quote is from, but I really like it. We don't mix people, we sort them. You know, who are you? Where do you belong? What group do I put you in? And that's a very polite way of talking about, talking about fear, because when you start sorting things, it's for a reason. There's a you are prejudging for a reason, right? And you might not even understand that reason. The illusion of choice. And in that process, you have the creation of what I call tribes. So clowning is very much alive, but the audience has changed. So now clowns surround themselves with people who like clowns versus the general public. Here is a term I really like that is included in that affect theory. Another author still at University of Chicago, Cyan Nagai, her name is, has a word called sublime and sublimity. It's a portmanteau. It's two words put together, stupid, sublime, all right? And here, this quote says, an experience of being astonished or overwhelmed, this is the definition, an experience of being astonished or overwhelmed by a vast or intimidating object. You see an intimidating object, I'm overwhelmed. I think this is the closest I've come to what is happening with clowns. They're overwhelmed. Warning, Will Robinson, fear, 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 shut down, walk away. And it has become universal. Like, people will blame a movie, but if that were true, why didn't Patch Adams like create this huge overwhelming love of clowns? It may have temporarily, but it certainly, I don't blame films. I think they represent what's already out there. So here, now that I brought you down to the depths, let's see if we can build something positive out of this. And Jeff, this is where I refer to your story. Fear, I read this, that the opposite of fear is curiosity. You cannot have both together. If you are afraid, by definition, you're not curious, because fight or flight, you know? I mean, if a car is coming at you, you're not curious about how fast it's going. You're out of there. So replacing the fear with curiosity, to me, is the answer. As a clown, you must build curiosity in your audience. And in this way, you will break down that difference. Jeff, do you want to tell the story you related? Maybe you don't remember it, but it was you at a hospital with a hat and a child in the room?
Yeah, I'd be happy to. You're so right about that in terms of clowning. Curiosities for the clown, as well as getting it. The story I think I told was that as a hospital clown, so as a hospital clown is great because you're not just with people who are going to like clowns. And those of you who know hospital clowning recognize that you got to get permission to go in the room. So in a pediatric unit, mother's going, come on in, and the little three-year-old screaming, and of course you don't come in. The door was open. So as I worked the other rooms and my partner and I were going around, I would just do a hat trick as I walked by without looking. So that became a little proscenium with a hat trick. And the crying didn't get less. It would tapered off but didn't stop. Then we had to go down to the pediatric ICU, three floors down, and I forgot my hat. So I had to go back up, leave my partner in the PICU. And as I got up to the floor, the charge nurse is standing there going, where have you been? I said, well, we needed to leave. She goes, somebody needs you. And she handed me my hat. And the kid had just decided the others. It created enough curiosity in your framework, Mike, of going by enough times and a little bit of space and came on up. And it took me 10 minutes to get out of there to get back to the PICU.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. And I'll just leave it there. I think that says it all. So here's that word again, and that author again, University of Chicago, Cyan Nagai. And again, it says, sublimity, what dulls or irritates or agitates, excessive excitation with extreme desensitization or fatigue. And I looked at synonyms of desensitization, see if I can find these in my notes. These are the definitions of desensitization. Callous, this is the audience towards clowns, callous, insensitive, unfeeling, unsympathetic, disconnected, or disaffected. And I think that that's what we're finding out there. That's what we're running into. So here is the world's smallest costume, right? We all know that right here. The world's smallest costume gives you permission as both a noun and a verb. Clowns, clown. It's what you do. And as Jeff just said, I think the hope really rests, the need for fools, the most success is in hospitals right now and with kids, because their fear is tied up in their physical health, not in wondering who you are. They just want to feel normal. I went to hospitals for forever. And more often than not, sometimes you'd walk in a room and you could hear the adults kind of inhale, like, oh, what are you doing? And the kid just wants to feel normal because the whole world is treating him like an object. So very often that's the case. Here is a picture I found of Patch Adams. I had to throw that in there. But the reason I really found this to be interesting, the most success right now, is that if you look up the word clowns, if you Google it, aside from horrific pictures, you will find adjectives such as, evil, scary, all negatives, negative adjectives. And you'll find page after page after page, scary, evil, like that. However, if you Google hospital clowns, you'll find nothing but positives, joy. And I engage you to do that, because I was like, this is it. This is where there's the least pushback and the most calling. That's not to say that clowns aren't needed or you can't fight the good fight. I'm just saying right here seems to be the biggest avenue of success. So here is my postcard from Chaplin to from Chaplin to Joker, right? These are modern times. In the end of that movie, he walks down the tracks, right? Away from camera, playing Smile, his song that he wrote for this movie. In the 50s, right around the time the tent folded, Nat King Cole made it famous by adding the lyrics. He didn't write the lyrics, but he made the song famous. Smile, though your heart is breaking. So that would be my words of advice to Joker, right? And again, to make this bigger than it has been, because it got pretty dark here. I want to remind you that Red Nose Day is the democratizing of clowning. The purpose of Red Nose Day is comic relief. It's for children in poverty. What could be better than that, knowing that this is where clowning is right now on an international level, that this little simple costume exists. Maybe the white face, maybe the costume is going away. Maybe we need to change to suit our audience. You know, they used to joke, don't change your act, change your audience. And that's what the circus did, right? That's what vaudeville did. But now the audience has changed while we weren't looking. We need to pay attention, right? I'm going to leave you with a story that's Native American. It's about two wolves. There was a wise elder sitting with his grandson, observing nature. And the old man turned to his grandson and he said, you know, within every person, there are two wolves. One of them is angry, he's evil, he's greedy, he's selfish, he's motivated by ego. He said, and they're always doing battle. You see the other wolf is sympathetic, empathetic, filled with joy and life and love. They do battle every day. It grew quiet. The little one listened. Finally, he couldn't stand it. He said, well, which one wins? If they do battle, who wins? And the wise man said, the one you feed. So here's my advice. Do your part. Feed the nose. I think I can. All right, that's your line, but I said it for you because I know you were thinking it. Thanks, everybody. I don't know how much time we have left. I hope we have time because I'd love to talk to you right now.
We have 25 minutes left.
Oh, beautiful, beautiful. So I'd be happy to answer questions, and I look forward to talking to you. Okay, bye. Cynthia. Hello, hi. Cynthia. How are you? Good to see your face.
Yeah, it's nice to see you too. I have so many other things aside from this to talk to you about and tell you about. I cut your tight wire in half and now it's portable. Everything's preserved. I just wanted to tell you that. Anyway, and everybody loves the story, just as an aside. Sorry. So you guys, I went and I picked up a tight wire that he used to use for teaching youth circus. And so I drove to Pittsburgh in 2016 or 17 and picked it up and brought it back here to use as my own. But when I got to Pittsburgh, I was very surprised to find out that it was portable only if you were really strong and had two people. and so I have since made it different from that. But it was made, the pedestals were made from the wood from McDonald's booths before they converted everything to fiberglass. And well, so it's so special. And I love telling people, of course I remember, Michael, I tell everybody that story every single time I take it somewhere. I'm like, I bought this from Ronald McDonald and these pedestals were made blah. Anyway, so my question for you is, you mentioned the article about American clowns, cliche. I didn't get the whole, wasn't able to make a note of the whole thing. It was back at the beginning.
Was that David?
Way back at the beginning before you even started talking about Jacobs.
Yeah, that was David Carlin.
Yeah.
Okay, hold that slide so I can write this down, please.
Sure. And again, at the end of this has my email address. You're always welcome to email me. And you know, this is my theory. This is the best I can do of piecing together what is happening, which is a shift in mores in the public perception of clowning.
Mike, one of the things that I found, which I find really frustrating, is that the moment that you say clown now, people, I'm scared of clowns. And I'm like, you don't even know what a clown is. That's what I tell my kids, because I'll get a 7-year-old and they'll be like, oh, I'm so scared of clowns. I'm like, you don't even know what you're talking about. Like, shut up. I don't say that, obviously, but
I think you should.
I don't say the shut up part, but I do say that I'm like, you don't know what clowns are, babe. You don't know what they are. And you know, we'll talk through it and we'll walk through it. And I always just say clowns are love, but it has become fashionable to be afraid of clowns. Like it's not even a conscious choice now. It's just sort of a fashion trend in our society to fear the clown. And
on the back, they say we have to stop this.
They're starting it. It's just, it's a pop culture thing. And one of the things I think is really frustrating to me, and I swear I'm going to dress in all black from top to bottom and maybe even put on a red nose and just go around at midnight and take down everybody's scary clown Halloween decorations. They make me so mad. I just want to take them away because furthers that.
I just want to, that just dovetailed with one of my experiences. When I'm encouraging my friends to come to my shows, I often say, we have comedy. We have comedy acts. I find I'm not even using the word clown, but I am clowning. That's what I'm doing. I just don't say that. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I purposely put the word clown in the name of every one of my books to try to work on the flip side of that, but it's very small. But and yet I got to tell you, in next year I'll be 50 years of working professionally as a juggler and a clown. In real life, it doesn't happen. You know, people aren't scared. It's a pop culture trope. I told you this. You probably heard it, Cynthia, too. Medical clowning, first time on an adult unit, it's the fourth floor, the elevator's open, and we're right on the nurse's station. There's a nurse sitting right there. She looks at me, and she goes, "I'm afraid of clowns." And I go, "Yeah, me too. They're kind of horrible." And she goes, "Yes, they are. I tell you, I have had some." And for 6 months, every week, the doors would open. She would look at me, and I would say that. And she didn't. She believed it every time she said it, and she enjoyed having someone to talk to. The fact that I was in full makeup and costume just was fine.
Yeah, if you agree with that, they have nowhere to go with their argument.
I mean, right, well, it's basic improv, yes, and. I would do rounds, and I'd come back, and she'd say, "Oh, did you see so-and-so? And, oh, I'm so glad you made them happier." And I'd leave, and then the next time, open. I'm afraid of that. Perfect clown partner.
And again, I'll say it. If you Google clowns, you'll see all the scary adjectives and the scary pictures. You Google hospital clowns, and you will see joy and empathy and healing. And so it's interesting. I mean, I walked the walk. It was an interesting time.
I thought your perspective on technology was really fascinating. Because I think people have more, specifically kids, have more exposure to representations of clowns than they actually interact with clowns. And so, the representation of the clown is scary because that's like what the person wanted to do, but that's not what a clown is. Like, just like representations of other identities can be really bad. But if you meet someone of that identity, that are just a person. So I thought that was really interesting. I hadn't considered that before.
And I think, Copper, I think you bring up a good point too, because my undergrad is communications, radio, TV. And Marshall McLuhan was this huge, he's Canadian, and this huge, the medium is the message. That was his famous quote. So what it's really saying is, for example, right now I'm basically doing a TV show, you know, and you fill, as a performer, you know, you fill the space you're in. On TV, it's all, your body is all facial. There's no, you know, if I did a clown act right now, you'd jump out of your seats, because if I jumped up and down, it would be inappropriate. Versus a circus act, if you got a 20 feet to fill, you're going to run back and forth to your audience. So whatever space you're in is what you fill. And extending on that, now that we've gone digital, I would go one step further. McLuhan is gone now, but it'd be interesting to hear what he says as far as communication now. Live is almost foreign to some children, especially over the last year and a half. So layered on top, we didn't even go there, layered on top of what we're talking about is not only are you afraid of clowns, but live? You're expecting me to respond instead of eat Cheerios or be on my phone while I'm on the computer, while the TV and the radio. I mean, there's overload on so many levels. That opens just a whole new.
Did I successfully unmute myself?
Please do. Love to hear.
Okay.
From.
It's so absurd. In a way, the first instance of a questionable clown was what, Jimmy Stewart in The Greatest Show on Earth. He was a clown who had to be in makeup. He was running from the police for doing something bad. No. For killing his wife because she asked him to. She had a chronic illness. So it was a humanitarian euthanasia. But John Wayne Gacy wasn't a clown. He only dressed like one, sort of with the loveliest makeup you've ever seen. It was one of the worst serial killers ever. So to me, that's where it began, but surely people are capable of understanding that child abuse exists, like in Joker. Horrific story.
Yeah.
Great performance. But it's not what clowning is. It's not what Dimitri did. It's not what Bello does even. Surely people are capable of holding both things, what happened, or you have to be either. That's what makes no sense to me, none. Yes. But yes, I loved your discussion of all of this.
Thank you.
It's good to deal with it directly and explain to people. Well, okay, but they're both true, but they're not both clowns. What you're afraid of isn't a clown. Okay.
Thank you, Judy. Yeah, I thank you for that insight.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's interesting times, and you're not going to win any, not you, Judy, I just mean in general, when a public has an opinion, as you know today on so many levels, you're not going to win an argument. You're not going to win over directly. But as Jeff said, your actions can tell a story that is inarguable. In fact, I was reading this not too long ago where people, it's a fallacy that your brain tells your body what to do. Actually, your body through practice will tell your mind what to do, which is why you practice. And it's a very interesting thing to try to implement, because more often than not, it's true. I did a series of workshops with teachers and storytelling. And I told them before a class, if you're having a bad day, just take a pencil and put it in your mouth like this. And when you remove the pencil, you're smiling. And more often than not, and that's what I was trying to say earlier, just by putting face on and walking out into public back in the day, the crowd would light up. And so they would give you the energy. Now you have to bring energy to it to win them over. We're at a huge deficit from where we once were. We never had to spend that kind of energy to establish a relationship. And it's really tough.
Yeah.
What else? I would really, for homework, if you guys want to look at affect theory, I call it affect, I suppose it's affect, right? Affect theory, but I actually wrote I've got that book on hold. I want to read it because I feel strongly it comes closest to diagnosing what I see happening. Because what we're really talking about is social mores. We're talking about society changing over time. And I think it's kind of a symptom of all sorts of other fear-based things we see these days. And I do think it has to do with communication and the digital life we lead now.
Can I just have a comment or question? Is that okay?
Please.
Yeah, so thanks for the presentation. I think you brought some really interesting thoughts into the conversation. And I think, and I'm already fascinated by clowns, I write about clowns and think about them and with them. And there's certain things that I think you're on with the notion that we are, that why the horror clown has become a dominant figure in today's cultural contexts, you know. And I think you're right on, you know, there's something very interesting happening, and I'm actually fascinated by the horror clown. And I would not go so far in thinking that a horror clown is not a clown, though. And, you know, sometimes I think affect theory also talks about attachment a lot. So why are we too attached to certain things? And why are we, and why can't we let go from certain attachments? And I'm also, I'm also thinking about that, as you said it earlier, that there's also a clown is not this kind of pure character, but it's very ambiguous. It has bad and evil. I think the white face is often already in a hierarchical position. Often, you know, there's like, if you see Footed and Chocolat, Footed is completely violent against Chocolat in the norm that I would say this is horrendous, especially if we think that Chocolat is a black performer, right?
Racist.
So you have, you have like those kind of, I think there's like an interesting, I would not go so far to ask for purity of a clown. I think there's something very interesting in the question that the clown can transgress or is a figure of transgression. And I think the horror clown is a figure of ethical transgression, right? Where I think some of I understand actually that there's like a certain kind of uncanniness, fear when one discovers a clown, right? Grimaldi, for example, I mean, very violent acts, if we believe, you know, the chronicles. Anyway, so that was one thought what I have, but also I think is the question of smartness and director choice in choosing a clown as a horror figure. Because the interesting thing is, nothing is more scary than a figure that represents innocent naivete or vulnerability. So the most actually, it's not just the horror clown. So if we think about children as in horror movies, right? So what is most scary is actually a child when it kills him, when it starts to get on its killing spree and becomes this kind of, oh my God, what kind of horror child is that, right? And I think the clown is a place interesting with the notion of childlike naivete. And I think that has that kind of, that means it, even though it is a horror movie, it still has in a sense a certain, I'm talking a lot, I'm sorry, but just because I'm really fascinated, it still addresses, because it's a certain kind of level of childishness and naivety that needs to be there in order for us to accept it as a horror figure, right? Because otherwise, that's why this figure works, because it should be actually good, but it's not. It should be a naive, but it's not. It should be a playful, but it's not, right? So that is the play, but it's an interesting, the clown noir, which I love actually the expression, clown noir over horror clown, so thank you for that, is I think a wonderful, I mean problematic, but it's still an interesting clown figure to explore, right? And Buffon's, you know, could be also part of, you know, I think there's just a lot of, and I stop there. I just wanted to say that.
And here's my question, like, yeah. where do you go from here? Like, how much darker can you get? You know, here is like campy. This is like your dark cousin. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. he comes to dinner. I don't want to talk about it. He was still funny, but now, like, how much darker can you get?
Yeah, but the question is, yeah, but it's interesting because if we are thinking about clown, this is kind of cliche, like situation of clown, the vulnerable self, the most inner self. What about if the horror clown is an expression of the self, which is actually a different expression of the self that we want, that we usually, you know, so it's an interesting complication. I'm not really against what you said or something, but
I don't take any of it personally, I think it's all observational, and agree with you,
but I just think that there's something into the clown which speaks fundamentally to clown, and which is actually not opposed to the clown, which I think, which is interesting to me.
What I think this does, and what I think it does, the movie, or the book rather, it removes redemption. Every clown character that I admire has redemption. There's something good about them, and hopefully something funny. And I really like your observations, because it puts clowning into a genre of horror in some, you know, some regards as a former clown. I used to
riffle
like that, but that's where we are. That's valid now.
Ante.
Yeah.
It sounds to me like you are, first of all, you're making my mind expand, which hurts, but thank you. but it sounds to me like you're also going back a little bit to what Mike was saying about Trickster and saying that it seems like maybe the horror clown is a trickster who's a little more on the trickier side, and that there's a validity to that, and that there's a natural balancing somewhere in that. Am I getting anywhere close to what you were saying?
I just came in, so it's a little bit large. I think there is something with the duality for sure, and I think. But I also think that there is something about violence, which also can be cathartic, right? So there's also thing, why are we drawn to the horror clown in our society? So I think it is more complicated than just, you know, I think there's a lot of thing to explore with the horror clown, which can be very fruitful, you know? And at the same time, you know, why, and at the same time, I think there are so many bad clowns on the world, you know, and I think they made the clown acts, which actually didn't serve the fact that the horror clown has become the predominant figure. Because if you go to a classical circus show, you often don't see good clowns. I'm sorry, and to say it as bluntly, but they are good clowns. And then, sorry, the other thing is like, there's also a lot of literature right now. You know, we're saying this scary clown, but there's a lot of books coming on circus studies, a lot of books on clowning, your books and stuff like that. So it is not just like, I don't have the feeling that this scary clown is like, has won the game, or that the clown noir is going to win the game. I think what you say is right. We are in a very interesting moment that clown noir speaks to our social condition right now. And it is interesting to observe why, but it is a clown still.
Ante, where are you? Are you in the United States or are you somewhere else?
Yes, I'm in the United States, yeah.
Okay. I was just asking because I was gonna ask if you were from wherever your accent is from, I was gonna ask a couple of questions about the ubiquity of the dark clown there, because here it just feels that it's getting more and more ubiquitous, I guess, for lack of a better word. And I appreciate. So I just am instantly very resistant to it. I don't have a lot of flexibility in a lot of what you just said, like Jeff said, I'm like, yeah, you're expanding my mind, but it hurts because I kind of like hating the people that hate clowns.
Yeah.
Only you've just given me
Don't hate clowns. The clown figure does still something, which is the interesting point. It does something. And this is, as long as a clown figure can do something to you, it is still, so that's the strong part. So we have developing now clown figure, which still has a certain kind of has a possibility to evoke emotion. The problem is maybe for a lot of people it's a bad clown, right? It's the horror clown, but it does work for certain people and for certain moments. The regular circus clown does not work because you go in the circus and the acts are so bad that the only thing what I see is like, oh my God, again a cliche act, again this thing. It's true, you know, it's unfortunately the case.
Ante, next time you go to a circus, let me go to a circus with you. I'll take you.
No,
we'll get to better clowns.
I love clowns. I worked with Misha Usov. I worked for Cirque du Soleil for 5 years. I'm no good clowns. I appreciate good clowns, but I think often, you know, people are, especially in Europe here, it's not so much because you don't have any more such a big circus culture. But if you go like in small circus context, road show context, those kind of situation where and not in really elaborated performances, you know, you often don't see a good clown work. Just the cliche type.
And I think in this country, there's a problem with circus schools, the folks who are on these, where clowning isn't taught in many, many places, or it's an afterthought, which then makes what you're saying become its own truism.
There's a fear of clown teaching.
Fear of clown teaching, yes.
Yeah. That's a whole different seminar.
So you guys with all this great big experience, I mean, I've got some history with it, of course, as Jeff and Judy knows, but like, so I find myself up against a lot of stuff that Ace Iko does because it is very narrow in its representation of circus. And one of the things that it does not represent at all is clowning. And if it does, it's a little teeny tiny bit, but you know, I teach mostly ground stuff and I do a lot of clowning with my young people, young and old. And, you know, I think Jens Larsen is the only other person in the organization that I know of that is in the same realm as I do. And I only know him by accident, but there's not a lot. Like I signed up for this. I told Mike this morning when he texted me, I see you're on here. I signed up for this entire conference for this one workshop.
Yeah.
So. My nose turns red about some stuff, but they don't bring it. They don't bring it here.
I think the difference between what I'm calling a clown noir and the classic clowning that I think most of us have in mind when we think of Popoff, Jeff Rez, Cynthia, you know, our clowning. What's lacking here is the love of laughter. And, you know, laughter is a release of tension. Laughter unifies the entire audience because when you're laughing, you can do nothing else but think about what's funny. As soon as you stop thinking about it, you stop laughing. I mean, there are very few things that are universal. 1,000 years ago, I'm going to suggest that people in China laughed, not unlike we do today. It unifies us. And here, there is no laughter. It is replaced with fear. And I would say that this movie, I mean, you wanted to take a shower when you were done. I mean, it felt, to me, I don't like this horror because it's too real, because it goes to a dark place, and that doesn't, I don't find any comfort in that, because there's so much darkness out there now. So that's why, even though this, I find this interesting observationally, but I find it disturbing if we assume that the arts reflect society. If you assume that arts reflect society, then I find this disturbing. If it is just a horror clown, then I say it might not be my taste, but you know, that's okay. Maybe it's the next stepchild of clowning, you know, mime, comedia dell'arte, horror clowning. Maybe it's another subset. Maybe it's a new tribe. I don't know.
Well, look what's happening. Clowning might be on the edge, but we're on the edge.
I think the word got stolen from us. I don't think people understand the concept. So we just need to perhaps not use that word as often and show, don't tell.
Redefine.
You know, to show them, don't tell them, mm-hmm. and they will understand.
Yeah, which way will America go?
Do you have a coin?
Yeah.
I think we're in the thick of it. I don't know.
I'm going to end the recording. You guys can keep, that's a brilliant ending.
I love
chatting.
Oh, we can keep chatting? You're just going to stop?
I'm just going to stop the recording and you're going to be the host so I can take off, have some dinner before I'm
hosting. Excellent. Oh, thank you, Cooper. Yay, Cooper. Copper, excuse me.